Amen, amen. Bwana sifiwe. Praise the Lord. How's the weather out there? It's really cold right now. It's rainy, so I'm really grateful that you guys have come to church. Very hard to wake up, but hopefully that one more hour has made things a little bit easier. Do we have anyone visiting with us for the very first time today? Anyone visiting for the very first time? Okay, I'm not seeing any hands. Anyone that has not been in church for a long time and today you're here? Anyone? All right, it seems like most of us are regulars. Let me begin by just praying, and then we're going to go to the Bible. If you have your Bible, just kind of find your way to Psalm verse 13, and then we're going to go from there. Father, Lord, in Jesus' name, thank you so much. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this morning. Thank you for every man, every woman, every child, every young person that has availed themselves in your house today. Lord, it's been a long week of prayer, and we even begin to see a glimpse of the answers to those prayers. And we thank you that you are at work in us, for us, and through us. And so we ask that you take your word and meet with your people at the point of their need. And we ask this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. All right. Today, I want to talk about a subject that has been in my mind and heart for the last few months. And it is the subject of when God seems distant. When God seems distant. And many of us, we go through seasons of our lives where we are experiencing God in real ways. That when we pray, he shows up. When we go to church, we get everything. And then once in a while, you get through a season in your Christian life where everything just seems to come to a standstill. When you pray, you don't feel like God is there. And so I want us to just track with me through these next few minutes as we look at this subject of when God is distant. And as an immigrant church, we came to America with so much hope for a better life, a life that is free from all the sufferings of the third world living. And then we get here, and for most of us, this has been true for the most part, but it hasn't been true without its challenges. Many of us have, and to some extent continue, to struggle with the pace of life in these United States of America. There are many of you who have applied for papers since you came here, and you are waiting for months and even years, and there is nothing that is coming your way. And there are many of you who are seeing God at work in other people's lives, but you wonder if he is at work in your own life. He seems to be distant from you and deaf to your prayers. There are many of you listening to me right now that are in hard relationships, court battles, looming divorces, broken hearts, you name it. Many of you are in very difficult relationships, and your future does not seem like God is listening to you, and you look into the future and you don't see anything. You just see blankness and emptiness. And when people come to you and say Happy New Year, you want to hit them in the face because there is nothing happy about this New Year. Whatever the situation you are in, I want you to know and be assured that God is near you. Amen? That is not far. He's not only near you, but he's also with you as your Emmanuel. If he seems distant to you, then this message is for you. And if he doesn't bless you, it is blessing me. So just hang out and see what God is doing in me as we go through this message. And I'm sure that most of you right now, you're either in that season where you don't feel like God is listening to you, or you're coming out of that season, or you're fixing to get in that season. So I want us to look at this passage today, and it's Psalms 13, and I want to read it in its entirety. Psalm 13, and David writes this, and it's only short little six verses. How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts, and day after day of sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemies triumph over me? Look on me and answer, Lord my God, give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. And verse 4, and my enemies will say, I have overcome him, and my foes will rejoice when I fall. And then verse 5, but I trust in your unfailing love, my heart rejoices in your salvation. And finally, verse 6, I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me. Very, very awesome scripture here. And this psalm is divided very easily into three parts. And it's divided into chapter 13, verse 1 and 2, verse 3 and 4, and verse 5 and 6. So verse 1 and 2 is the question of anxiety. Verse 3 and 4 is the cry of prayer. And verse 5 and 6 is the song of faith. And so I want us to go through these verses really slowly and clearly, because I don't want you to miss what God is saying through his word this morning. Now, David says in verse 1 and 2, how long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemies triumph over me? And the question is, how long? And I know most of you, when I read this, you're thinking, yes, Dennis, I feel that way. How long? And this question is repeated four times in these two verses. And it portrays a very intense desire for deliverance and a great anguish of the heart. David is in a bad place in his spiritual life. It is not easy to prevent desires from generating into impatience. It is hard not to enter into murmuring while we wait for God to answer our prayers. And you begin to complain and to wonder, how long, God? I've been waiting for weeks. I've been waiting for months. I've been waiting for years. I've been waiting for decades. But nothing is happening. How long? Our days appear to be very long when our souls are cast down. Minutes begin to feel like hours. Hours begin to feel like days. Days begin to feel like weeks. And weeks begin to feel like months. And months begin to feel like years. And it just seems like the time is grinding to a halt and nothing is happening. But when things are good, it seems like time just get wings and begin to fly. But in our not so very good days, it slows down painfully. And in these moments, it seems like God has forgotten us forever. And David says, how long will you forget me forever, O Lord? It feels like God has hidden his face from you. How long will you hide your face from me, O Lord? And I want to encourage you, as you're listening to me this morning, just as you're going through whatever difficult time you're going through, the length of your anguish is not determined by anyone or anything. God is doing something in your life. Amen. Amen. God is at work. He is doing something in your life. And when God is done doing whatever he's doing in you and for you, with that pain, that time will come to an end. But life needs to go on as you wait for God to come to your rescue. You cannot sit in a corner and begin to whine and say, oh, poor me, poor me. Life needs to continue. Because when God is done, you can look back and say, oh, that is what God was doing. And I don't want to downplay what you're feeling and what I'm feeling, that your pain is legitimate because the cause of that pain is legitimate. So you're not pretending to be in pain. And I know sometimes as Christians we say, rejoice in the Lord always, and I want you to rejoice. But at the same time, I don't want you to be to lose the fact or the fact that that pain is real. And David's pain was real. That's why he's writing this psalm. But the truth of the word of God is also real. Because we can get to a point where we are so focused on the realness of our pain that we forget that the word of God is also real in and within that pain. God will never leave you nor forsake you. That is real and that is true. Whatever you're going through, know that God will never leave you nor forsake you. God will never forget you. And many of us, and I know as I grow older, I see in life when things are going well, people run away, people come towards you. And you have many friends when your bank account is full, when your mortgage is paid for, when your children are healthy, when everything is going well in your life, friends congregate around you. And then you get to this time when David is saying, how long, and friendships begin to be very thin and scarce. And they begin to run away from you and to forsake you and to forget you. But God will never leave you nor forsake you. Say amen to that. Amen. He is always there. He will never forget you. Listen to what Isaiah said. Shout for joy, you heavens. Rejoice, you earth. Burst into songs, you mountains. For the Lord comforts his people and will have compassion on his afflicted ones. But Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me. And God is saying all these things. God is telling them how good he has been to them. But then their response is, the Lord has forsaken me. The Lord has forgotten me. And then God's answer to this question is this, to this statement is this. Can a mother forget the baby at her breast and have no compassion on the child she has born? And when God thinks of what is the most intimate relationship that a human being can have with another human being, it is the relationship between a nursing baby and a mother. And it is very, very, very hard, for almost impossible, for a mother to forget the baby at her breast and have compassion on that child that she has born. But God says this can happen. And even though she may forget, God tells you this, my friends, I will not forget you. Amen. Amen. God says to you, the same way that your pain is real, the same way that your pain is hurtful, the same way that you feel the weight of your pain on your shoulder is the same way that I want you to feel the weight and the awesomeness and the goodness of God in your life at this point. He will never forget you. And he says this in verse 16. See, I, God, have engraved you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are ever before me. It's very interesting when you have a pen and someone gives you a number and you want to write it down and you have no paper. Why do you write it? Write it in the palm of your hands. Why? Because it will be in front of you. Now, the problem with me writing on the palm of my hand, if I sweat, that number is gone. God does not sweat. And so, when God says that I have your name, Dennis, written in the palm of my hands, he will never forget you. Guys, God loves you. God is there for you. It doesn't matter who has run away from you, who has forgotten you, who has forsaken you. God is there. Say amen. He will never forget you. And during this time, it may feel that God has hidden his face from you. And this may be true, but a hidden face is not a sign of a forgetful heart. Verse 2 says, how long must I wrestle with my thoughts, and day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Now, look at the origin of this hopeless estate. What is the origin? Verse 2, it says, how long must I wrestle with my thoughts day after day? It begins, you look at this and you see how hopeless David sounds right now, and you say, where did this come from? And I want you to look at this verse and see what is going on here. These painful thoughts have been brought by what he's investing in. His investment is he has invested in these painful thoughts, and he has done it over and over and over. And when you do that with your pain, when you put thought in your pain, and that is the thing that drives you from morning to evening, midnight to dawn, it doesn't only remain thoughts. Your thoughts don't remain thoughts. Your thoughts morph into something else. And since you have invested in having these thoughts, they mature into sorrow. And then sorrow is a constant estate of deep sadness caused by loss, disappointment, or other misfortunes. So your thoughts give birth to sorrow. But sorrow does not remain sorrow. It morphs into hopelessness. And so the thing that began as a simple thought, you invest in it and it becomes sorrow. And this is why you hear people saying, I'm depressed. I'm depressed. And the sorrow, when it is invested in over and over, your depression does not remain depression and sorrow. It morphs into hopelessness. You lose hope when you accept that your current circumstance is your position. Don't accept your pain and say, God, this is my portion. It is not your portion. Amen. Amen. God is doing something with that pain, but it cannot become your identity. It can't become your identity. So the origin of this hopeless estate, it begins by the counsel we give ourselves from within and the thoughts and criticism we receive from outside. It's very interesting when you're thinking negative things about yourself, when your pain has become part of you, and when somebody now comes and says that thing to you, then you're like, you see? Confirmation. I'm not the only one thinking that I'm terrible. Everybody else thinks I'm terrible. So the pressure from within and without is causing you to get to this state of hopelessness. It is easy to forget the word of God and to feast and dine with our thoughts, and also to give precedence to the words of other people. We need to bring down these strongholds of sorrow, and in their place to start erecting pillars of praise. Amen? Amen. Whatever is going on in your mind, in your heart, in your life right now, it is easy to focus on the negative things that are bringing you down and forget that there's a good God who has given you so much more, and you begin to focus on that. So that is the question of anxiety, the origin of which is thoughts, sorrows, and then hopelessness. But number two, we look at the cry of prayer. It is easy to remain in your pain and to pitch camp there and to have your tent and all your camping attires there and sit there and begin to make that your identity. But David, even though he is desperate, he is in pain, he is sorrowful, he doesn't remain there. The cry of prayer. And I've come to discover that God, when God brings you in a place of pain, your prayers are not the same. Your prayers are deep. Your prayers are meaningful. Your prayers are they are meaty. They have substance in them. So David says this, look on me and answer. Lord, my God, give light to my eyes or I will sleep in death. And my enemy will say, I have overcome him and my foes will rejoice when I fall. That's the prayer of David. He's crying out this prayer to God. Look on me and answer me, Lord, my God. I love that David, in the middle of sorrow and pain, does not forget his place in the heart of God. Amen? The pain and suffering does not drive God away. It might drive your friends away. It might drive your enemies, your family away. It might drive even your spouse and your children away. But God is not scared by your pain. And when everybody is packing their belongings and leaving your life, God is packing his belonging and is moving in to your life. He remains to David, the Lord my God. He has not forgotten his place in the heart of God. That even in pain, God remains to David, my Lord and my God. I want to tell you this if you're a Christian. Your sonship is not a temporary state of affairs. It's an everlasting thing. When God calls you his son, that bond does not end when you are a bad child. And I think sometimes God gives us children to relate with them to see how permanent our relationship is with him. Look at your child. You know, one of the things that even if your child is a murderer and is stoned to death, the mother and the father will still cry at the funeral of that person. The whole village might be happy that this person is gone, but the parents are never like that. Because this is an eternal relationship. God is not only your God when life is a sunshine. He remains your God even in the darkest hours of your life. Amen? And I want that to sink in the same way that your pain is a reality, the goodness of God also is a reality and not a myth. In verse 1, he says that God has hidden his face from him. But here, he prays to God and say, don't hide your face from me anymore. Look on me and answer, Lord my God. Give light to my eyes. And that is, let the eyes of my faith be clear. Let me be able to see things that my fleshly eyes cannot see. That I may see my God in the darkest hour. Let my eyes of watchfulness be wide open, lest I be entrapped, and lest the eyes of my understanding be illuminated so I can see the right way. If your eyes are not open to the goodness of God, here, I want you to pay attention, guys. Because pain as a way of closing your eyes to see the goodness of God. If this happens and your thoughts take over, those thoughts will conceive sorrow, which in turn gives birth to hopelessness. But hopelessness closes our eyes to God and tells us that we are done. And if God does not open your eyes to see his love, to see his grace, to see his mercies, then the result is the sleep of death, according to this psalm. In verse 3, look at this. You see the progression here? That your thoughts become sorrow, your sorrow becomes hopelessness. And when a man or a woman reaches the end where they don't see anything and all hope is gone, the only thing that they feel can comfort them is for them to be there no longer. And when you hear that somebody has killed themselves or committed suicide, don't look far. It began with a thought in their mind. That thought was bred and it gave birth to sorrows. And then those sorrows were so deep, depressing, and they became hopelessness. and a man of no hope. Not a good man. They said, I think, and I hope I'm getting this right, that you can live for about 3 days without, three weeks without food, 3 days without water, 3 minutes without air, but 0 minutes without hope. You cannot live without hope. Hope is a very important thing. And so Paul will call Jesus the hope of glory. That we have a hope in Christ. That when all this is said and done, we're going to go to heaven. In verse 4, he says, and my enemy will say, I have overcome him, and my foes will rejoice when I fall. I don't know if you understand this, but one of the most painful things in life is when your enemies are crying for your downfall and then it happens. It's very painful. And David is praying against this. Now, I don't know who David's enemies were, but one thing I know is that our greatest and ultimate enemy is the devil, Satan. And in your time of need and pain, he comes to you and say, did God really say? If you are the Son of God, turn this bread in stone into bread. He comes at those times when you are vulnerable, when you are weak, when you feel like life is not there anymore, and he comes and he brings lies into your head. The Bible says that the devil is the accuser of saints. He likes to see the downfall of Christians. And I think, personally, just as like there is rejoicing in heaven when one sinner turns to God, I think that there is also rejoicing in hell when one saint turns away from God. And the devil is a 24-hour open business. He doesn't sleep. He's always looking for the downfall of saints. And he will come to you at your weakest moment. When your prayer life is dead, he comes. When you don't read the Bible, he comes. When you feel like nobody likes you, he comes. And he begins to cement those thoughts in your head. And he makes you stay with those thoughts, turning them into sorrow and hopelessness. And his desire is for you to die. And to die without Jesus. And guys, the natural thing to do in times of trial is to run away from God. And I say this all the time. Don't run away from God in your trials. Run towards God. Run towards God. Don't run away from God. When life is hard, don't run. When it doesn't make sense, don't run away from God. Run towards God. I remember the story of the prodigal son. The prodigal son ran away from the father. But the father is waiting for him at the gate, day in and day out, sitting there, hoping that one day in the horizon, the son will come running towards him and is waiting. And the father, your father who is in heaven, is also waiting for you. He's waiting for you to wash you, to clothe you, and to bring you in his table of abundance. All you have to do is come. Don't run away. Don't run away. And even as you're praying, I want you to notice one thing. That when we pray about pain being taken away by God, our only answer is that things are going to be okay when the pain is taken away. Paul prays to God, please take this thorn away from me. And he prayed several times and God said, no, my grace is sufficient for you. And even if the pain does not go away, God remains God. Because you know what? On this earth, the Bible says, you will have trouble. But at the end of all this trouble, we shall be face to face with God. Guys, I've read ahead. I know how this story ends. And it ends awesomely. There will be rejoicing in heaven. No more tears, no more sorrow. No more death, no more pain, no more sickness. If you're saved, this is your portion, not your pain. Your pain is not your portion. Your portion is you are a child of God. And one day, you're going to be with him forever in heaven. Don't despair. Don't give up hope. But pray. David cries to God and say, look on me, O Lord, and answer me. Keep praying. Keep praying. Let the cry of your prayer be, God, take away this cup from me, but not my will. Your will be done. You know, one of the surprising things, guys, is Jesus, the Son of God, in the moment of anguish. Because I think sometimes when you preach about Jesus, he's this superhero that doesn't feel hungry, doesn't feel pain, doesn't cry, doesn't have all these things. But Jesus, as a human being, sits and kneels and pray at the Garden of Gethsemane, and the pain is so unbearable, and he tells God, take it away. Take it away. I don't want this pain. I do not want this pain. Jesus said that. So if you are there, you are in good company. That Jesus says, take it away, but he doesn't stay there. He goes one step ahead and he says, not my will. Because my will, I don't want to go through pain. In my will, I don't want to feel uncomfort. I want to be happy and less absence of pain and all these things. And that's my prayer. But at the end of the day is, what is the will of God? Maybe it is the will of God for you to go through what you're going through right now. So as you're praying, take this cup away, but say, not my will, but your will be done. So that is the cry of prayer. The question of anxiety. He is in pain, but he doesn't languish in his pain. What does he do? He cries to God in prayer. And then finally, the song of faith. You know, it's very interesting to see what David is doing over here. I have overcome, and my enemies will say, I have overcome him, and my foe will rejoice when I fall. But he has prayed. You know what? I love verse 5, the way it begins. It says, but I trust in your unfailing love. Yes, all these things are true. Yes, I'm in pain, I'm in sorrow, I'm hopeless. My enemies are triumphing over me. Yes, all that is true. Maybe even your face is away from me. All that is true. And I want you to see that when David is singing, he's not singing because the prayers have been answered, but he says this, but I trust in your unfailing love. The never failing love of God. That was what anchored David in hope. My heart rejoices. I trust in your unfailing love. Because of that, my heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me. Amen? This is awesome, guys. That in his pain, he doesn't call a party and throw this big pity party with all these things that are going through in his life. He says, I have prayed. When you have prayed and you have said amen, it's time to start singing. I don't know if you heard me. You hear me? When you have prayed, even before your prayers are answered, why do you sing? Because you trust in the unfailing love of Jesus. That your heart is rejoicing in the salvation that he has given you. And that is the reason why you sing the Lord's praises, for he has been good to you. And I like another verse that says, he has dealt with me in abundance. I love that. When we come to this place, then we can sing. Not because our circumstances have changed, but because they have shrunk the light of our great God. Guys, listen to me. The size of your praise grows as you recall the pit of sorrow from where the Lord removed you. So the deeper your pit of sorrow, the louder your praise will be. But it's so opposite, right, of what we do. That the shallower our pit of sorrow is, the louder our praises are. And when those sorrows become deeper, guess what? Our sound, our voices become less and less and less. The deeper the pit, the louder the praise. For the psalmist here is rejecting the low estate of his despair and embraces the unfailing love of God. You know, one of my favorite things, times, is to see a young couple in love and the promises they make for one towards one another. And to see them in their wedding, in their tuxes, and their white dresses. And the optimism of love is there. And they are proclaiming and announcing unfailing love to this other sinner that they're getting married to. And then as they get to know each other, you know, those who are laughing are married because they know what I'm talking about. When they get to know each other, when you begin to know their sin and their imperfections, your unfailing love begins to fail. Not so with God. He rejoices in the salvation of his soul. And I want you to notice this, that the circumstances remain the same, but the focus has changed. Instead of letting his burdens weigh him down, he begins the song of praise. He recalls his salvation and concludes that he is singing, not because life has gotten better and easier, but because his view of God has gotten bigger. Guys, there lies the secret. Your problems will never become smaller. They can only shrink when your focus is taken to something else, the goodness of God. In the story of the prodigal son, when the big brother came, he heard singing and asked what was going on. He was told that his brother who was lost has now come home, and the father has dealt bountifully with him. The father has been good to him. His famine was replaced with a feast of a fattened calf. His tears wiped, and where there was sorrow now, there is singing. Where there was gloom now, the father's goodness reigns. And there is celebrating when this son that was once lost has been found. And if his truth is still marching on, the truth of God. As you ask the question, how long? Let me tell you today, how long? Not so long. Because the same God who began the good work in you will take it to completion until that day of Christ Jesus. You ask me, Pastor, how long? Not so long at all. Because I consider this present suffering, Paul says, not even worth comparing to the weight of glory that will be revealed in us when Jesus shows up. How long? Not so long. Why? Because justice will roll down like the waters and righteousness like the ever-flowing stream. How long? Not so long. Why? Because even though we run from him, he runs after us with a never stopping, never giving up, never breaking, always forever loving arms. How long? Not so long. Why? Because even though I see death reign on this earth, I know, and I am convinced that my Redeemer lives. And he will stand upon this earth forever. And those who are with him will also live with him forever. How long? Not so long. So my friends, sisters and brothers, look to Christ. Look to him. And in him, you will find your answer. Look to him suffering for you on the cross. Look to him going into that grave for you. Look to him trampling on the serpent's head for you. Look to him rising again from the dead for you. And you will hear the answer. How long? Not so long. Because our Savior said, on the cross, it is finished. David determined to believe this in his life. Even in the midst of his mess, David believed in the unfailing love of God. And I want to call us into this space. I want you to let yourself commit to doing the same thing that David did. That even though he was in pain, he prayed. And after his prayers, he started singing and commit the same. How? I think, starts with confessing where we are. Don't ignore the pain. It's there. It may not go away. But when we are honest about where we are from, where we are, our only response should be to cry out to God for help. Why? Because David calls him my salvation. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is your salvation. Amen? Let's pray. Father, Lord, in Jesus' name, I'm before you right now. Lord, we are your children sitting at the foot of the cross. And our hope is that on this cross, there is nobody there. It's an empty cross. And it is that hope that we have in you, in that cross that is now empty. But we know that our pain is but temporary in this world. Lord, I can look into this crowd right now, but I can't see their pain. I can look into this crowd right now, but I cannot see their struggles. I can't see their tears. I can't see their loneliness. I can't see the place of sorrow that they are encamped in. I can't see it. But at this particular moment, I am praying to you, Lord of glory, to you who is able to see in the secret places of a man's heart, where a man cannot see, God can see. You say that you knew me when I was being formed in my mother's womb, and that I cannot hide from you. If I go to the highest heaven, you're there. If I go to the lowest valley, you're there. If I go to the farthest corners of this world, even there you are. Thank you that you are omnipresent, all-powerful, all-present God. Thank you. Right now, God is ministering to somebody right now. I don't want you to ignore what is going on in your heart right now. God is saying something to you. I don't know what it is. I know He's speaking to me. Or whatever it is, please be receptive to it. Take your pain and give it to Him. Take your sorrows and surrender them at the foot of the cross. Begin even now in your soul to sing. To embrace the goodness of God, the unfailing love of this God who loves you more than anything. Father, I pray that you work in the hearts of your people right now. I know, God, you are able to do immeasurably more than all we ask. You say, is there anything too difficult for you? The answer is no. Oh, Father, meet us, all of us, at the point of need. Your children are crying to you right now in their sorrow, in their pain, in their hopelessness. They're crying to you, who is their hope? Father, minister to them, we ask. Show up for them in real and meaningful ways. You are a good God. Yes, your love is unfailing. Yes, your grace is amazing. Yes, your mercies never end. Your love is everlasting. Thank you, Jesus. And all God's people say, Amen. God bless you.